Now, this will be the eighth lecture on this course. Here, in this lecture, we are going to see whether we can generate chemicals and fuels from carbon dioxide other than the synthesis gas route. We have already talked about the synthesis gas route, either in the form of a dry reforming or tri reforming, combination with the water gas route reaction and the carbon deposition reactions. Now we are going to look at the new industrial processes that can be generated. Okay, it is only in the stage of formulating, but nothing has come out. You will see at the end of the lecture. The objective is to develop new industrial processes for fuels like gasoline, diesel, jet fuel, and industrial chemicals. This is other than the route going through the synthesis gas. This places a condition that the carbon dioxide has to be captured from sources like flue gases and then purified. Okay, when you are not capable of purifying, then what you can do is try reforming. Possibly this avoids the step of purifying the carbon dioxide and capturing the carbon dioxide. Now the different technologies for separation, okay, the separation or purification of carbon dioxide, keeping cost in mind, or okay, we are keeping cost in mind, therefore that is why we are giving only limited technological developments. Use of basic solids like zeolites, polymeric amines, new materials, or liquid monoethanol amine and water. These are the sources where you can use capture carbon dioxide, purify, so that the other gases are not absorbed or going into the solution in monoethanol amine or water, and then do. Now, most common chemicals from carbon dioxide are sodium bicarbonate and sodium carbonate by the Solvay process. This we are not going to deal with because this has been a textbook knowledge at this point of time. Other chemicals that have been made by the directly from chemical carbon dioxide is the urea and salicylic acid by thermal process. Thermal process means a catalytic process. Okay, thermal energy is put input there. Okay, that is what it means. Methanol production through the synthesis gas, okay, that is also possible. Or carboxylation of ethylene epoxide. Direct methanol production from carbon dioxide is under development, which we will see subsequently. Now, the starting point in direct carbon dioxide started from the observation that in 1975 it was shown that transition metal complexes activate this inert molecule. This has to be done in a separate lecture, so that is why we are not expanding this. How carbon dioxide can be, we have included in the introduction lectures, we have talked about it, but how carbon dioxide can be activated in the transition metal complexes. So the earliest work was 1975 by Aresta, new nickel carbon dioxide complex synthesis and properties and crystallographic characterization of carbon dioxide bis tricyclohexyl phosphine nickel. Okay, you may remember that I was talking to you about ligands which are having nitrogen or phosphorus. Those type of ligands can be easily activated on the metal ions. Here it is a combination of the carbon dioxide and phosphine ligand. This leads us to the question, why do we concentrate on certain complexes like nitrogen and phosphorus containing ligands? This has to be linked with the coordinating ability and also the nature of the coordination as compared with the other ligands containing coordinating species like oxygen, sulfur, and other atoms. I hope you understand this. What is meant by here is, when you have an amine ligand or a phosphine ligand, the lone pair electron is present in a more or less the p orbital of the nitrogen or the p orbital of phosphorus, and that is very highly directional, and that is why they are capable of coordinating to the metal ions. And these ligands are very highly activated. That is why Wilkinson catalyst and other catalysts contain phosphine ligands. So therefore, this is one aspect that we can activate carbon dioxide by complexing it with metals. But this is not what we are going to do now. We are going to do this subsequently. But what we are going to do here now is whether I can directly put carbon dioxide into a catalytic reactor and convert them. That is what we are going to see. So the situation now is carbon dioxide is used now for the production of urea, organic and inorganic carbonates, salicylic acid, and in food conservation. That is what we have seen. These chemicals, the production of these chemicals are all textbook knowledge now. That is why we are not going to take this any further. We are going to look at new options. However, the total use of carbon dioxide, even though we are saying that we are using carbon dioxide in the formation of inorganic and organic carbonates, salicylic acid, urea, and food conservation, but you will be surprised to see that we are only using 0.6% of the anthropogenic CO2 emissions, which is the total amount of the CO2 that is coming out is 33 GT per year. This so many tons per year is being given out of which we are only using 200 metric tons per year. That is 0.6%. So you can imagine now what is the amount of the carbon dioxide that we are not utilizing for the production of the chemicals. So now what are the possible processes? That is what we have to see. Homogeneous, heterogenized, or heterogeneous and enzymatic are the possibilities. Carbon dioxide, why this molecule is like this is the question we have to ask. Carbon dioxide molecule, why are we not able to take like any other molecule and activate it? The reason is carbon dioxide can be considered to be in the potential well of a stable molecule. If you are taking the potential energy diagram of the carbon dioxide, it is very deep down. Therefore, we have to see how we can activate this molecule. There are two ways of activating this molecule. One is low energy process where CO2 is incorporated in the organic or inorganic substrates. That is what we saw just now. It can be either incorporated in the monoethanol amine or something like that, or in a metal ion and complex with it. Now we can also do it in another way. What we have to do is a high energy process. What we are doing here is where the oxidation state of carbon is from +4 to a minimum of -4. We are trying to convert this. It is not, need not go to -4. It can go even to -2. When you take carbon dioxide and convert it into carbon monoxide, you are changing the oxidation state of carbon. So therefore, carbon monoxide is more active than carbon dioxide. Whereas carbon dioxide is the most stable oxidation state of +4. So now, if we are to go look at the chemicals that can be produced, okay, here I have tried to list them, but it is not the complete list, but I have tried. A few of them are already known to us, therefore calcium carbonate. I have already talked about the calcium carbonate, I hope you remember. Here I have talked about sodium carbonate in the way, sodium carbonate means calcium carbonate also is possible. So the corresponding free energies are given in kilojoules per mole. So C1 and CN compounds that can be generated from carbon dioxide. Now I hope you are able to see the stability, the lowest energy, that is what we talked, low energy process where the carbon dioxide can be considered to be in the potential well in the molecule. That is the reason is it is having an free energy in the gas phase -394 kilojoules per mole. So now if we want to produce any of these chemicals, what is to be done is the question. Okay, all these chemicals can be produced from carbon dioxide, but we have already seen that we are only using 0.2-0.6%, and we are only using it only for the production of urea, salicylic acid and few carbonates, inorganic or organic carbonates. Why is this question? Okay, first problem is CO2 insertion. If I have to insert CO2 in a molecule, for example, I have a hydrocarbon, insert the CO2 to get the carboxylic acid, it is an exoergonic process. C1 reduce the hydrogen and increase the hydrogen require energy. Okay, if you want to reduce it, for example, you go to the methane, it is a very highly endothermic process. So these are the problems that is there in the direct use of CO2 to produce the chemicals. Now the list that I have given on the left hand side, the table, we have already seen how we can produce some of them. We are going to see many of them can be produced electrochemically, electrocatalytically, or photochemically. We are not looking at that or those possibilities now. Today we are only looking at the possibilities of generating these chemicals by thermal means, thermal activation of the CO2 only by a catalytic means. So you can see that even you can produce the liquid hydrocarbons, which are the fuels or diesels, ethylene and benzene, and all other things can be produced. Production of carbonates, carbamates, urethanes, lactones, pyrones, formates, and induces. These are going to be homogeneous catalysts. If you are interested in producing any of these chemicals from carbon dioxide, you have to use the suitable homogeneous catalyst rather than heterogeneous catalyst. Now, what chemicals that I can make out of carbon dioxide using heterogeneous catalyst? Dimethylbenzene I can do, cyclobenzenes I can do. Already discussed about the synthesis gas. So I'm not going to talk about the synthesis gas. You know, why we are interested in ethanol is, so you must be understanding, we will also tell you, there are various ways of methanol can be used subsequently to produce chemicals. So therefore, producing ethanol from CO2 is important. We see some of the atoms that have been done industrially to produce methanol from CO2 little later. So let us look at this science of methanol production. Okay, CO2 plus 3H2 giving rise to methanol and water. So there are in the world today, there are about 19 methanol plants and 75 metric tons of methanol is produced by this reaction. Okay, then we have the, from methanol, I told you, why are we interested in methanol? Because we are interested in producing varieties of polymers. From methanol, I can go to PET, polyethylene terephthalic acid, things can be. So now there is another process that has been put into the practice. This is it goes with the name. This is a process. It's not nothing to do with the name. Okay, this is produced by action. Methane plus carbon dioxide plus water. A single step process, not a CO2 plus methane giving rise to dry reforming, CO2 plus water giving rise to steam reforming. We are not talking about that, or methane plus water giving rise to steam reforming. What we are talking about it, putting methane, carbon dioxide and water in this stoichiometric ratio produces 4CO and H8H2. I hope you are able to see here, this is 1:2 ratio. So therefore, directly you can go to 1:2 ratio. So this position, if you can get, then directly you can go to the methanol. So this process given by Ola. Ola, you know, laureate in organic chemistry. Another is the tri reforming, which we have already discussed. So the three reactions that we have talked about, okay, steam reforming, dry reforming, and also the carbon deposit, carbon partial oxidation. Steam reforming and partial oxidation. Methane plus carbon dioxide giving carbon hydrogen. Methane plus water giving rise to carbon monoxide and hydrogen. Methane plus oxygen giving rise to carbon monoxide and hydrogen. So these all these thermodynamic quantities I already talked to you. So we are not going to repeat. So this is another route, but this is not met gas. You can see you have to do independent reactions and get carbon monoxide, hydrogen synthesis gas. Here the synthesis gas that putting in this tri reforming is more or less 2.4 or something like that. Whereas here it is 2 in the met gas process. That is why it is directly giving rise to methanol. coupling CO2 the steam reforming will give synthesis gas methanol with H2CO. That is also possible. Here you have coupled this dry reforming with steam reforming. So therefore, that also gives me very near to 2 ratio for methanol synthesized. Now, the only problem in dry reforming is what we have already seen, that dry reforming, it requires very high energy input because it is an endothermic process. That is process takes place around 840-850 degrees Kelvin, and we have to use some amount of the fuel that we are producing back to for the reactor. There is a major problem is the carbon formation is a major problem. It's avoided in the dry reforming because partial oxidation of methane is also taking place, so therefore carbon is used. Methanol to dimethyl carbonate, dimethyl ether, all of them are fuel additives. So once you have methanol, you can make any ether and other things which will be also used as fuel additives. Homogeneous catalyst, low temperature, ruthenium phosphine complex. I hope you are able to see now why this phosphine ligand, why nitrogen ligands are more catalytically active ligands. Okay, this aspect we will try to answer some other time in a greater detail. Okay, at the moment we will assume that the nitrogen containing ligands and phosphorus containing ligands will be the complexes, the inorganic complexes containing these ligands will be catalytically active species. The, you can see even at 413 degrees Kelvin, around 100, 150, 120 degrees, you are already 150 degrees, you are already having a turnover number of 200, 221. Okay, so therefore it appears that it is possible. Now I have here tried to summarize all factors that are relevant for the CO2 reduction on heterogeneous catalyst. Okay, not for this is the, even though it may appear to be general, but it has a very specific place in the CO2 reduction. The first and foremost is the nature of the metal. We have already seen the nature of the metal has to be nickel or nickel or iron or some of the low cost metals. We'll come to it why these metals, but anyway, the choice of the metal is a very important thing. Then the catalyst structure, I will come to it a little later. Okay, what is this catalyst structure is? Then even with the even if we have these two, a catalyst structure can be the support or promoter or the total combination. We are not specifying any one of them. So the in all those catalysts, what we are worried about is how we will be able to disperse the metal and how we will be able to keep the particles in the same state. So uniform particle size of the metal. The uniform particle size of the metal here has to be less than 10 nanometers. Okay, and then it is not enough if I have uniform particle size. I also should have the distribution of the metal on the support must be uniform. It should not be on one domain and other domains need not be there. Then the surface area is as usual as an important parameter. These active sites that the metal sites that we have put, they have to be active. They should not be agglomerating or conglomerating or in a domain. Okay, in all these things, if we look at all these possibilities, there is a problem here. The problem is if I can achieve all these points 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 points, the stability of the system and long term operation of the system becomes a demanding parameter, because the catalyst is sintering, agglomerating and all those things. So therefore we have to now make sure, that is one of the reasons why we are looking at, I hope you remember that the uniform particle size we were talking about is less than 10 nanometers. So we should not allow these particles to grow up. Then there are varieties of promoters and supports are used. I will just give you a glimpse of what is this. Later on we will look at it. Okay, for example, if I were to take in all these catalysts, most of the catalyst is a metal put on alumina or some support like that. Okay, we will assume like that. So if I were to take that catalyst and put copper, Okay, for example, methanol synthesis catalyst is copper zinc oxide alumina catalyst, or copper zinc oxide zirconia catalyst. What is this all these additional additives, zinc oxide or zirconium oxide, or what is it that is doing to the catalyst is the question. Okay, you remember that the point number two, we emphasize that the uniform particle size of the metal. Okay, here copper is the, even though is a metal, that is not the active metal that we are talking about. The active metal that we are talking about is nickel or iron. So the copper zinc oxide combination or copper zinc oxide zirconia combination keeps this metal particle size at the same, it does not allow it to grow. Okay, then alumina, titanium, gallium oxide, vanadium oxide, they are all doing some kind of I hope you are on, they are doing, some of them are doing a physical property of the acidity increasing, or some of them are facilitating their reduction behavior. The catalyst is normally, the catalyst is prepared, the metal supported catalyst is prepared by loading a metal oxide or a metal ion. So for example, in the case of nickel, we will use nickel nitrate. So nickel nitrate has to be reduced from nickel 2 plus to 0 valence state. So therefore, this VOX, MOX, MgO, all of them promote the reduction of the metal sites. MqO, methane to olefins, ethylene and propylene, it is a commercial process today. So methanol to olefins. So this is a total Honeywell and China, Dow, Union Carbide, many of them are using the MqO process. This only to show. Now we will quickly go through the catalytic hydrogenation of carbon dioxide. This is direct reduction of the carbon dioxide, not the going through the synthesis route. That is another route. Okay. I hope you by now you would have understood why we are going to synthesis route. Carbon dioxide is a stable molecule. Carbon monoxide is an active molecule. That is the logic there. Since molecular hydrogen, the problem in the direct hydrogenation of carbon dioxide is, where will I get the hydrogen is the question. So the problem, the issue is that we can get hydrogen today from three possible routes. The three possible routes are from the biogas, biomass or biogas. Another one is the fossil fuels. Third one is water. Okay. Since molecular hydrogen does not naturally exist in its pure form, it is typically pure form in greater quantities, okay, maybe very small amount of pure hydrogen exists. It is typically derived from natural gas, oil, coal, biomass and water by means of various chemical, physicochemical, photolytic, electrolytic and biological transformations. We will be, if time permits, we will talk about it, but at the moment in this lectures, in this series of lectures, we are not going to talk about hydrogen production. Okay, we are assuming that hydrogen can be produced from any of these sources, at least from three sources: water, biogas and the fossil fuels. From the environmental viewpoint, it is crucial that its production is also CO2 emission free. If we go in the fossil fuel route, I will once again end up with the CO2 emission. If I go in the biological gas route, I will end up with the CO2 route. Only if I go to the water route, I will be able to produce the pure hydrogen. So therefore, this is another issue that is called a carbon neutral situation, but we will not worry about it. We are only worried about how we will be able to generate hydrogen and can use this. Since hydrogen can actually substitute fossil fuels, it opens up the possibility to even have a positive CO2 balance, reducing overall CO2 production. Okay, when we are going to use hydrogen as the fuel, when generating heat and energy upon hydrogen combustion, yielding water as the only product. This is a topic which we have been talking about it, but anyway, we will see that again in another occasion. Hydrogen can be produced from fossil fuels, water and biomass. We have told you these are the three possibilities at the moment. Okay, when I say at the moment, what we mean by that is we are producing hydrogen, we are not making hydrogen. I hope you understand the difference between producing hydrogen and making hydrogen. The emphasis will be on their environmental impact and economy in CO2 hydrogenation to value-added chemicals. For example, if I were to take water electrolysis, it is possible to produce hydrogen, but using that hydrogen, if I were to produce a chemical, it will be very costly. because water electrolysis itself is having an overvoltage of the order of 0.1, 0.8 volts or nearly 1 volt. So now if I were to take this heat steam reforming of methane, which we have studied number of times, methane plus water giving rise to hydrogen and carbon monoxide. Okay, water and carbon monoxide, water gas shift reaction gives rise to CO2 and H2. Once again, you are producing hydrogen. Okay, but I have already talked about these two reactions. These two reactions are very highly endothermic reactions. You have to put in lot of energy into it. We are worried about producing energy, but we should not be putting energy to produce the energy. CO2 from fossil fuels can also be done by autothermal reforming, which we have not talked about it. All these routes are possible, but what we are worried about is two things when we talk about hydrogen production. For CO2 hydrogenation, we are only talking about hydrogen production for CO2 reduction, not for as a fuel. So the first thing is I must be able to produce economically, because the chemical that we are producing should not be costlier than the because of the hydrogen production. Okay, that is the first problem that is existing. So therefore, the three choices that we have for the production of hydrogen is now can be only if the fossil fuel sources only is the economical route for the moment. But that at the same time, it should be produced. If I were to take the steam reforming of methane, it should be produced in the ratio in which I want. Otherwise, it is not possible. Then, since we are going to use the air, there will be deactivation of the catalyst. So air separation is required. Biomass can also be converted through liquefaction, pyrolysis, and gasification. These are the three routes that are possible. Gasification requires sulfur and carbon tolerant catalyst, because if you are going to gasify the hydrocarbon biomass, I have given the equation here, you will see what is the difficulty. So because if you are directly gasifying the biomass with water to produce hydrogen, CO, CO2 and then lower hydrocarbons and tar. Okay, so therefore it is necessary that we have to, it is not a very easy route. I hope now you understood why biomass route is not a convenient route for producing the CO2 hydrogenation, or water electrolysis also is not a convenient route because they are not economical. Then they are also deactivating the catalyst. Both the are the cases. Now, what are the possibilities for the CO2 hydrogenation by heterogeneous catalyst? Hydrogen and methane are two high energy materials. I hope you have seen. If you are not seen, you please now refer back. You will be able to see methane and hydrogen is not given, but anyway, both are very high energy materials which can be used for large scale transformation of carbon dioxide to valuable products. Okay, so maybe there is a picture that is possible. Okay, so I hope you are able to see that. See, the CO2 conversion to fuels are useful commodities. So I can take CO2 plus hydrogen to give rise to methane, CO2 plus hydrogen to higher hydrocarbons, CO2 plus hydrogen giving rise to oxygenates, carboxylic acid and other things, CO2 plus methane giving rise to the synthesis gas. So all these things are possible. So that figure illustrates the most attractive heterogeneous catalyst routes. It is important to highlight that the hydrogen based routes directly yield the fuels and chemicals building blocks. Okay, I hope you saw that. The hydrogen using things directly gives you the methane, higher hydrocarbons or oxygenates. Whereas when you take carbon dioxide and methane, you are only getting the synthesis gas. From the synthesis gas, you have to generate the chemicals that you want. So most attractive heterogeneously catalyzed routes. It is important to highlight that the hydrogen based routes directly yield fuels or chemical building blocks, while CO2 conversion with methane results in this gas, which can be converted to the above products in an additional process step. From the economic point of view, the direct transformation of CO2 is preferable. I hope you understand why we are worried about the direct conversion of CO2 and not the route to the syngas. CO2 conversion of CO2 to hydrocarbons. The hydrogenation of CO2 to methane is highly important from the industrial point of view. There are there are several uses of methane. Okay, steam reforming of methane, heat and electricity generation. That is why natural gas is used as a substitute for gasoline, diesel and liquid petroleum. I am sure you would have seen already all your autos and other things are running on the gas, natural gas. So what happened in this is like I have told, shown it here now. One is a German firm, Audi, I hope you have heard about it, the automobile, builds a windmill electricity and hydrogen to convert biomass based carbon dioxide. They have produced about 1 kiloton of methane consuming about, this is the ratio, it has not that they produce only 1 kiloton, that is not true. Okay, so what is the thing, if they consume about 2.8 kilotons of carbon dioxide, they are able to produce 1 ton of methane. This ratio is given only to make sure that the process is more or less economical, that's all. Okay, the catalyst that the variety of the catalyst that have been used are given in this table. I hope you are able to see ruthenium and titanium dioxide, or cerium ruthenium oxide, or palladium magnesium silica, palladium nickel silica, and nickel and the zirconia system, and nickel and MCM 41. Okay, I hope you are able to see. The particle size, I have already talked to you about the particle size. It has to be less than 10 nanometers. The temperature at the ruthenium case is lower. In other cases, it is slightly higher. Okay. The conversion is given here. You can see the CO2 conversion is 100%. Methane conversion also is 100%. So, therefore, this is a very attractive process. CO2 to methane is an exothermic process and low temperature operation favorable to suppress the if I can operate this CO2 to methane at a lower temperature, then I can suppress the water gas shift reaction. 100% of yield you can see at 453. I hope you saw that data. 453, 473 degrees, 100% conversion is seen here. But as I told you, the catalysts are very tricky catalysts. So we do not know whether the catalyst will be able to withstand for a longer time, or it will be agglomerating and other things. So therefore, experiments have to be carried out to keep the particles smaller than this, and also make sure that it is stable under the conditions. Now, the other process that is possible is the Fischer-Tropsch process. Carbon dioxide hydrogenated to hydrocarbons by Fischer-Tropsch process. Just like carbon monoxide is hydrogenated to hydrocarbons by Fischer-Tropsch process. But unfortunately, the same catalyst which is used in the conventional Fischer-Tropsch process, cobalt and iron, can be used, but there is a problem. When we use cobalt catalyst, it does not give me the Schultz-Fleury distribution. I hope you understand what is this Schultz-Fleury distribution. It only tells you what is the amount of the, for example, C10, C14 and all those things. This is a distribution function. So if you take the CO and hydrogen and put it Fischer-Tropsch process, you can maximize it for diesel production or petrol production or any other gasoline production. But if you take carbon dioxide and hydrogen and use the Fischer-Tropsch process, the cobalt can be used, but it is low activity for the reverse water gas reaction. Iron based catalysts are not selective. Cobalt based catalysts are selective, but it is not does not show the reverse water gas reaction. So therefore, there is a problem here. Hydrogen production is a question here. In all these catalysts, manganese, copper, potassium and cerium are the promoters. Here I am only mentioning all these things. If time permits, we will also take one lecture on all this. What is the supportive you have to use? What is the promoter? Is there any science behind them? Okay. Now, anyway, I will tell you here. I have already talked about it. Manganese and copper improve the reducibility of the metal. Iron here, but it can be anything. Nickel also, it is possible. Now, when I promote you to potassium, you may knowing all the Fischer-Tropsch catalysts will have a K2O potassium oxide. It is only because it is capable of increasing the adsorption of carbon monoxide or carbon dioxide. That is the reason why we are taking this. Now, the cerium, what is the reason? Whereas when you do all this manganese and copper, it is only facilitates the reduction of the catalyst. When I take the cerium, the selectivity advantage to their lower hydrocarbons is more. Whereas if I, that is the problem that we had, full fluoride distribution is not holding good for CO2 hydrogenation. For the CO hydrogenation, it is holding good. So therefore, that is why when we use the promotion of promoting with the ceria, it gives rise to the C2 to C5 catalyst. Now, in the Fischer-Tropsch process, if we are interested in the methane production instead of the hydrocarbon production, then we have to use, I have already told you, we are simply using copper zinc oxide alumina or copper zinc oxide zirconia catalyst and other things. But we should also try, because we have already seen cerium promotion gives rise to C2 and C5, so it can give rise to C1, but the process economics have to be assessed or addressed. The CO2 capture has to be done, and the CO2 conversion has to be done. Okay, so therefore, these are all the problems that is existing. So now, if you have to take oxygenates from carbon dioxide, okay, for example, carbon dioxide to make methanol instead of methane, okay, as early 30 years ago, the Lurgi has come up with a process of CO2 to methanol. CO2 to methanol was this is a Lurgi process. 2011, as late as 3 years before, or 2.5 years before, Carbon Recycling International, a company, converted today, as I already told it to you, 4 kilotons of methanol from CO2. Okay, but the process is the capacity is 40 kilotons. Okay, you should not think only they made 4 kilotons. I only showed you 4 kilotons because if they take 4 kilotons, they have consumed nearly about that 11 to 12 kilotons of CO2. Lurgi and the Air Liquid Forschung, this is another German company, and a few others, I will not put the names, they have put their commercial synthesis of catalyst for CO, CO2 based water formation, alcohol and hydrocarbon, and esters and ketones. But the details are not still available. In this case also, the Carbon Recycling International companies catalyst also, the details are not available. Only the data that is available to us in the open literature is that they are having a capacity to do about 40 kilotons of methanol. This is this process, Lurgi and the air liquid process, is not specific to methanol, but it is using similar to methanol catalyst, commercial methanol. They are claiming to use, okay, I didn't put it here, they are claiming to use the Sud-Chemie methanol catalyst, but I do not know whether it is true or not, because they are producing alcohols, hydrocarbons, esters and ketones. So therefore, so here I have shown, this is only an introduction, we are going to see a little later. So you can see why these ruthenium complexes are ruthenium phosphine complexes. Okay, forget about ruthenium, many other metals can be there. Why these phosphine ligands? Okay, here you are, trimethyl phosphine is put here in the case of ruthenium catalyst. The structures of typical catalysts are shown here. Keep it in mind, some other time we will be talking about how these complexes are capable of activating carbon dioxide, why they are doing it and all those things. So now, in this slide, I have tried to put everything in one possible. This is what is known to us, carbon monoxide plus hydrogen giving rise to the hydrocarbons and other things, formic acid, formaldehyde, methanol and all those things. This is all known process. Here, it's a simple projection. I do not know whether it is taking place truly or not. Carbon dioxide and hydrogen, it is carbon dioxide active. When I put the star, it means adsorbed. Carbon dioxide adsorbed plus 2 hydrogen adsorbed gives rise to carboxylic acid or formate ion. Then the formate ions are transforming to give rise to methanol here and methanol in water. So it can go in this route, in the formate route or formic acid route. Okay, variety of these are the possible steps. But it is not true if all of the steps are present or each one of the steps is subsequent to other, and all those things are not clear to us, so that we are not talking about it. This is just to show you about the catalyst that is possible for the Fischer-Tropsch process. We will not take that. So the another chemical that can be used is the dimethyl ether. Okay, it is a direct substitute for diesel. Okay, when a methanol catalyst is coupled with an acid catalyst like alumina, it one can make C from CO2 dimethyl ether. So Lurgi mega DME heat integration methanol formation and subsequent dehydration. If you take methanol and dehydrate it, 2 methanol giving rise to dimethyl ether. That's all. So therefore, there is a process that is put by the Lurgi that is called mega DME heat integration, because it is an endothermic process. Therefore, there must be an heat integration necessary. So now, the catalyst copper zinc oxide. The role of zinc oxide is to keep morphology and stabilize the copper species. Promoter like zirconia, silica, alumina, lanthanum oxide, dispersion of the copper. This is all for methanol synthesis. Direct relation of turnover number with the monoclinic. If you take the copper zinc oxide catalyst with the zirconia as promoter, what it means is that the turnover number, it depends upon what is the extent of the monoclinic structure of the ether RO2. If you remember, that is the first thing I put in the characteristics of the catalyst, the metal and the crystal structure. So I am giving you only one example at the moment. I will be subsequently talking about all of them. Okay. So the monoclinic form of the zirconium oxide alone is capable of giving rise to the high turnover number. Okay. The nanostate also play a role, but at the moment we are not going to worry about it. So synthesis of methanol using the ruthenium catalyst, here I have shown. So you can see that CO2 is giving rise to a cyclic ether, and that cyclic ether is giving rise to methanol when I use the ruthenium catalyst and hydrogen. If I use the cyclic ether with water, I will end up with the back to the carbon dioxide. So that is the situation with respect to the chemicals today. If you have any questions, we will answer them.